On my main home server, I had an issue. I wanted to add more storage to the system, but all of my SATA ports and PCIe cards were all filled up with drives already, so I didn't have an easy way to expand normally. But when Movespeed reached out and wanted me to take a look at their little USB SSD drive, I noticed I had quite a few USB ports available on that system. Some of these were capable of 5, 10, or 20 gigabits per second, which seems like quite a bit of speed. So today I wanted to take a look at using USB storage in mostly a home server context, and just see how well USB storage works, what type of issues it has, is the power consumption reasonable, and other aspects of USB storage to see if it's a reasonable way to add a few more drives. Likely when you first think about USB drives, you think of little USB flash drives like these. And these really aren't great storage. They're really cheap and easy to toss into a bag or a pocket and just have it if you might need it in an event, but they're extremely slow storage, especially when it comes to RAM performance. They're known to having a high failure rate, and these are just overall not great drives if you want to have reliable, fast access to data. Some OSs like Unraid are built around being able to boot off these drives, but beyond use cases that are designed for these drives, I really wouldn't want to use these in much more than that. And with the advent of USB 3 getting popular in devices a little bit over a decade ago, devices like this external hard drive got finally practical, and was able to take full advantage of the mechanical hard drive speeds over USB. But one thing is, mechanical hard drives are pretty darn slow, especially in random I/O, so it really doesn't take that much to take full advantage of these mechanical hard drives' performance. But I did something interesting with this little C drive here, and I just put a 1TB SATA SSD in it. And surprisingly enough, it can actually get pretty darn close to the full speed of that little drive, even though this was built for a hard drive and was never intended to have an SSD put in it after. One interesting thing to note with this DIY conversion is how little space is actually taken by the chips that are needed to do this process. Modern 2.5-inch SSDs have very small boards internally, and there's only one or two chips needed to convert this USB interface into SATA. So that's where drives like this little Movespeed one makes sense. Because if all you're going to need is a couple of chips, why have a large enclosure when you can have a tiny one? And this little Movespeed SSD is essentially the same internally as this DIY conversion. It's just dinky, happens to have a USB-C port, which is great for some newer systems, and can be put almost anywhere else these standard little old USB drives have. Now let's take a look at performance of this Movespeed SSD and other USB storage drives. I'm first going to start with a crystal disk mark run just to get a basic sense of how this drive works and a way for you to easily compare with other drives you have. This drive on Crystal Disk Mark looks very similar to an internal SATA SSD, showing how the USB controller chip and the USB hub on the system is not significantly slowing down this drive compared to what it's fully capable of as a SATA drive if it was one. But Crystal Disk Mark can't show everything, so one test I wanted to take a look at was sustained read and write speeds. Sustained read speeds are fine. It's able to read the full drive at almost the full speed throughout. This shows that there's likely no thermal throttling, and when doing this test, this drive is just sitting out in the open with no additional cooling or airflow. Sustained writes, on the other hand, drop significantly, going from their full speed to averaging maybe about 20 to 30, 40 megabytes per second in that range, bouncing up and down a little bit for the rest of the drive. It took about 5 hours to write the full 1 TB of data on this drive, meaning that this is likely a QLC drive. That is likely a good limitation of the smaller physical size, because TLC NAND or MLC NAND is significantly less dense and would take more physical space, potentially than this drive could easily have squished into it. Another thing to note performance-wise with this drive is this is a USB 3.2 10 gigabit drive, which means if you want to get the full speeds out of this drive, you need a system that's capable of the 10 gigabit speeds. And unfortunately, USB branding and labeling stuff is kind of a mess. Some motherboards show it okay, some motherboards hide it and have speeds of different devices on it. It's really annoying these days, and one thing is if you're using this on an older system, those systems with the USB 3 5 gigabit port seem to be limited to about 300 and some megabytes per second on this Movespeed drive and almost all other USB storage I've looked at. Luckily, random I/O performance isn't that much affected doing this, and it's mostly sequential speeds. One other thing I wanted to know was if there was additional CPU overhead using USB storage compared to internal SATA or NVMe storage. So I devised a quick test where I'd copy a 10 gigabit file onto another location on the same drive at a given speed of 100 megabytes per second. And looking at the results, the USB storage did roughly in line with some NVMe drives that I had and other internal SATA drives. So at least from that test, it didn't seem like USB drives have an excessive amount of CPU usage used when copying files. There's still a lot of other things to be cautious about before selecting a type of storage. And the next thing I want to take a look at is reliability. USB is a checksummed interface, so that means those little bits of extra data that can check if the main part of the data is actually correct. And USB should be able to correct for any possible issues in the cable or other parts of the interface and fix it. So I wanted to double check that was working correctly, and I filled this drive full of data, and I used ZFS's own checksums to read about 200 terabytes of data from this drive to see if it would report any issues or have any problems. And it didn't. ZFS didn't report any checksum errors even after running 200 terabytes of scrubs. So it looks like, at least on this drive plugged directly into the system, it didn't have any problems. But one thing I do want to note is USB allows for much more ugly interfaces relatively easily. And what I mean by that is you can do things like nested hubs or long extensions or poor connections or other things like that very easily that can potentially cause data loss or other issues. I had this drive plugged in directly to the system, which is likely the best application, but a lot of these USB cables have been used quite a bit, potentially are worn down and not working as well. Another aspect is power consumption, and all of these USB drives do quite well when it comes to power consumption on the system. These low-end generic USB drives I had doing around did very well with about 0.05 amps at idle and 0.08 amps under full load, but they're not super fast anyways. These faster SATA-based drives, like this Movespeed drive here, had about 0.08 amps of long idle, so it seemed like it went to a deeper power state, about 0.014 amps during kind of a working idle, so when it's mounted and it's been used recently, and the peak power consumption I got on this little Movespeed drive was about 0.23 amps. Which is more than my DIY solution and likely shows that things have improved. So while it does use a little bit of power and it does warm up a bit, doesn't seem to be an issue in either the power consumption or heat, and is well under the maximum amount of USB power that almost every device has available to it. Overall, after working with this little USB SSD, I was generally pretty impressed with how well it worked. The performance was decent and almost on par with an internal SATA SSD, and I didn't have any reliability issues or other problems really when working with it. And while USB storage is not my go-to under many circumstances, when you don't have another option, it works pretty darn well and there isn't any glaring issues that would keep me from wanting to use it. So if you're in a circumstance where you don't have a great other option in a home server, like no more SATA ports, it's a pretty good way to add a bit more storage and realistically with pretty reasonable performance. I actually ran all of my VMs off this little drive for a bit and didn't really have any issues. I don't run anything too intensive, but for a lot of home server uses, it's gonna work fine. Thanks for watching this little video on USB storage. Let me know if this is kind of interesting to you, if you have any other thoughts in the comments below. And overall, thanks for watching.